in Vermont with Murray Bookchin. It's August 31st, 1994. In response to the question about forming a radical or revolutionary movement, you often say that forming study groups is a first step. I was hoping that you could discuss your approach to forming study groups.
My approach is not very original. I make no pretense about that. Study groups have been part of the revolutionary tradition going back into the 19th century, and perhaps even earlier than that. Now, a study group generally consisted of a small number of people who normally took a text, a particular work, that they respected. They might pick, if they were Marxists, Das Kapital. If they were anarchists, they might pick, for argument's sake, Kropotkin's writings, such as Factories, Fields, Workshops, or even earlier than that, his books on the French Revolution, two-volume French Revolution. They might pick Proudhon's writings, What is Property? And they would sit around, often guided by someone who was pretty knowledgeable of radical ideas, and I'm now being quite ecumenical. It could be Marxist, it could be anarchist, it could be utopian socialist. They might take a utopian socialist novel and analyze, read it aloud, discuss it, and analyze it. And the text, the book, would basically be a guide for them and a way of bouncing off ideas and interchanging ideas. Now, a study group, of course, comes together when one or more individuals decide that they have a certain affinity for a shared body of views. However broad those views may be, they still have it. I'll give you an example. Dostoevsky, the Russian novelist, the great Russian novelist, was arrested years back in his youth for being the member of a study group on Charles Fourier's writings. Many people don't know that. What happened was that he, together with either fellow students or fellow novelists, he was one of Russia's greatest writers in the 19th century, and I'm going back to the 1830s and 40s, met in an apartment, and they began to read Charles Fourier's writings. Charles Fourier was one of the most famous utopians of that era, the early part of the 19th century. Of course, in Dostoevsky's case, the study group was found by the secret police, the Tsarist secret police, and Dostoevsky faced a mock execution in which he thought he was going to be shot. And sentence was then, as it were, pardoned by the Tsar, and he was sent to Siberia, which led him to write novels about his life in Siberia. So a study group would be composed of people who, making contact with each other, decide that they want to form a kind of intellectual community. And they then will sit down with a text normally, or if they so want, they may sit down and drop an agenda of issues they want to discuss each week. And they will sit and they'll study this, and through the give and take of discussion and the absorption of whatever knowledge a particular book has to offer them, they gradually enlarge their minds, as it were, and they become more sophisticated intellectually and begin to try to achieve a certain coherence. And such a group, by the way, doesn't have to be fixated ultimately on a particular work or even a particular line of study. It can then become a kind of unit. You may call it an affinity group, you may call it a political group, you can call it a club. Then become involved in some type of political activity depending upon what their political orientation may be. This has been a very fundamental way during all times, not simply during periods of revolution or periods of social upsurge, or periods of tremendous political excitement. It has occurred even in periods of, and especially in periods of deep reaction like today, to keep like-minded people together, to give them solidarity. You know, there is a life that comes out of a study group that consists not only of study, and to give them a basis for formulating shared ideas that they can put into practice. So I don't regard this as an I don't regard a study group as an academic exercise. I regard it as a nuclear way, a molecular way of building a movement. And all the more important, I think a study group is all the more important, because if we are going to build a political movement, and I believe in a movement, I believe in ultimately in a mass movement, and I believe in an organized movement. Let me make that very plain. If we are going to build a political movement, we have to have some coherence in our ideas. Because when we get to talking about the 60s, we'll see how important that really was in determining the whole life cycle of the 60s, its rise, its flourishing, and its decay. The idea of a coherent outlook, always subject to modification, never dogmatic, capable of change, but still focused. Without being focused, one strays off in every which way direction with disastrous results. So that's a study group. And it is so old that it goes back to the actually to the 18th century, during the period of the French Enlightenment. Like the encyclopedists or philosophes, as they were called, prior to the French Revolution of 1789 to 1794, met as study groups every Sunday. They ate together, they drank together, they exchanged written stuff. And let me tell you, these writings are now classics in the literature of philosophy and science, mathematics even. D'Alembert was a mathematician. One thinks of Denis Diderot, one thinks of people like D'Alembert, one thinks of people, a whole host of these men who sat together and formed study groups, essentially, in the form of a kind of eating together, an afternoon together on a Sunday, where they would banquet or eat well together and talk about ideas and pass manuscripts around, as well as read manuscripts aloud, and or each one sometimes writing his own manuscript. Unfortunately, many of them were male. People were not into feminism as yet. And thereby writing what turned out to be one of the greatest examples of literature in ideas, as well as novels and whatever you like. They even wrote novels and read them aloud to each other. That's a study group. And that kind of study group that occurred, say, in the 18th century, provided the ferment that gave rise to the French Revolution. Ultimately, many of their writings appeared as pamphlets. These pamphlets were either read by fairly well-educated people, or they were reworked in very simple form for ordinary workers and peasants who were literate, and soldiers and sans-culottes and whatever you like, until by the eve of the French Revolution, the taking of the Bastille, the very guards standing in front of the palace, guarding the palace of the king, were reading the writings that came out of these study groups. And coachmen, as Arthur Young, who visited France at that time, an Englishman who traveled through the countryside and through Paris, reports, even the coachmen holding the reins of the horses were so preoccupied with reading that the horse would sort of drive the carriage any which way, and the coachman had to be reminded that it was his job to take a traveler from one place to another inside the city of Paris. This is such study groups, let me add, create a kind of Enlightenment era. Here people become excited when ferment begins to take place, when political life becomes active, when a political culture begins to develop among the ordinary people. Such study groups become a major source of literature, and ultimately knitted together. They begin to form various clubs, they begin to form leagues, they can begin to form federations, they begin to form whatever you like, and in some cases even parties, depending upon how you want to define the word political party. Okay. So my point is that a study group is not an academic exercise, and in a time like the present one, when, in my view, we really are undergoing an ideological counter-revolution. I mean, it isn't like the McCarthyite days when people were being persecuted for their beliefs. It's not fascism when people were being sent to concentration camps. But ideologically speaking, in terms of ideas, people are losing an understanding of the meaning of words like socialism, anarchism, and a word that I have a very great preference for, by the way, despite my strong libertarian tradition, and that is communalism, not to be confused with communism, and not to be confused with communitarianism, which generally means opening up pet shops and food co-ops, fine, good work, medical clinics, but still communalism, which means really the attempt to empower the community, municipalities and towns and neighborhoods, which is very close to what I believe in, what my libertarian, left libertarian traditions really converge toward, and which in my political views is called libertarian municipalism.
When one presents the idea of forming study groups to many people, they often respond very pessimistically with the simple idea that you just can't get people together in groups anymore. People work jobs during the day, they have responsibilities at night, watching television, etc. How do you respond to these people who take a very, very pessimistic view towards study group formation?
Well, in many such cases, I'm not too sure that they really want them. And I'm going to be very frank with you. And there's a time when you do one kind of thing, and there's a time when you do another kind of thing, and there's a time when you can't do anything at all. First of all, I don't believe there's a time when you can't do anything at all. I mean, people seem to form groups when they go to the stock market, or when they visit their brokers and keep looking at the ticker tapes, at least as they flash across the screen. Oh, people get together in groups. There's no question about it. I've seen groups of young people sitting around listening to MTV with Beavis and Butthead or whatever their names are. The question is what they are really inclined to do. It's not that they can't get together in groups. They form groups. The real question that such people who ask a question of the kind that you... The real problem that people who ask the question that you really have posed is what are their intentions? They do get together in groups. That's hogwash. The real issue is what do they get together about? And it's not because they have to work very hard and they come home and they're very tired, because when they're very tired, they go ahead and they look at television, and they sometimes stay up till 1 o'clock in the morning, although they may have to get up at 7 or 6 to go to work the very next day and hardly get any sleep. I've seen that. And I question basically the sincerity of such a remark. They can't get together in groups. They do. They get together in groups in bars. They get together in groups on street corners. They get together in groups when it comes to looking at MTV or going out to dance or whatever you like. And sometimes, you know, to kick blacks or other minorities around.
Even in stadiums, they get together by the tens of thousands.
Yes, they get together in stadiums. That's hogwash. The point is they're not interested in getting together in groups like that, and I'm not that interested in trying to get them together. There are always going to be a minority of people, especially in times like these, who will want to study, who are starving to study. We get letters, Janet and I, my companion and collaborator, get letters in our post office box, P.O. Box 111, Burlington, Vermont, 05401, Green Perspectives. We get many letters every week from people who say, we got to keep in touch with you. We wish we were living in Burlington so we could be part of your group, because we have a study group in Burlington. In fact, our study group is now sort of, in a sense, multiplied into several subgroups of people who are interested in doing political activity. Others are interested in doing specialized studies in, say, in history or possibly philosophy or political theory. And then we all get together as one group here, a dozen or so, with people continually visiting us and coming from abroad in many cases, or coming from different parts of the United States or different parts of the state, and all they keep saying is, we wish we could live here, because we want to be part of a group. We want to be part of the kind of group that you are because of what you're studying. And we're studying basic social theory and history, as well as programs for the future. So I don't accept that argument as being very valid. And if there are, unfortunately, people who work so hard that they only have time to eat and sleep and use the bathroom and can barely fornicate with each other, all I can say is, you had better look at your life and ask yourself, what are your values and what are you living for? Are you just becoming another form of cattle or beef on a hoof, grazing until the slaughter comes? Or are you vegetating? I mean, life has to have some meaning. So I challenge that statement, to be very frank with you. People do want to get together in groups. The question is, what we're talking about is what kind of groups. And in this case, I am only interested, I am primarily interested, not out of any elitism, but out of a recognition of reality, I'm interested in addressing those people who want to get together in groups to study social issues. And I use that word social issues in a very broad sense.
You mentioned the word movement several times in the discussion so far, forming movements. In the 1960s, this was a word with a capital M that was used quite often. Could you describe how you became involved in the movement?
I would say that I got involved in the movement with a capital M very early on, before the movement really began to call itself the movement. I originally lived up in the northern part of the Bronx in New York City, close to the end of the city. It was not really the suburbs, but it was in the more, shall we say, countrified part of the city itself. I lived there up to 1962. I had been in the old left of the 30s, had gone through the Eisenhower and McCarthyite period, saw the decline of the labor movement, but was still very politically active to the extent that it was possible. And the first sparks I began to see of the movement came from two sources. The first one, and nobody seems to mention this often enough, is Women's Strike for Peace. Women began to get together somewhere in the neighborhood of around 1959, 1960, to fight nuclear fallout. And that was one of their main issues. Generally, it was supposed to be a collection of women, which finally became a national organization that was opposed to the what seemed to be the oncoming Third World War. You must remember around that time movies like On the Beach with Ava Gardner and what's his name again?
Gregory Peck. Fred Astaire.
These were very dramatic films. I mean, today many people would regard them perhaps as corny. We're making the rounds in movie theaters, and they talked about the end of the world and the after a Third World War as a result of radioactive fallout, which was ultimately going to reach Australia. And there was a lot of discussion even before that about the effects of nuclear fallout, in which I personally was very much involved. I wrote a leaflet called Stop the Bomb after the 1954 explosion of the first hydrogen bomb that killed two Japanese fishermen. It had a worldwide circulation. It's one of my proudest pieces of writing, of agitational writing. literally a couple of thousand letters from Japan, because it was translated into Japanese and put on the third page of the Asahi Shimbun with a circulation of 7 million daily readers. So everybody kept writing to us and sending us their pictures. Women's strike for peace got underway, give or take, around 1959, 1960. And I was deeply involved with women in a radical housing project that had been built by the socialists in that distant part of the Bronx. And several of the women formed a real nucleus there, and a very guiding nucleus, a very important nucleus that helped play a guiding role in this women's movement. And they were the first ones, and this is very interesting so far as I can recall, to call a demonstration in New York City since the 1930s. Everybody had forgotten about what a demonstration was like. And they rallied thousands of women all over New York, demanding an end to nuclear testing and demanding an end to nuclear bomb making and demanding also initiatives for peace. And the cops went crazy because these were new policemen who had never seen a demonstration before. They didn't know how to handle it. And so these very well-dressed women, many of them wheeling baby carriages, were viciously attacked, and it produced a horrendous situation. Everybody was outraged by that. And so it's very important to know that they started a ferment going. At the same time, freedom riders were going down south in buses, but were largely ignored. These were made up of whites and blacks going into segregated areas where whites and blacks were not supposed to sit together in the same bus. This was before Rosa Parks did anything. And this gradually escalated until finally students very famously sat in the white section of Woolworths in the southern state and refused to leave when they were ordered to go into the so-called colored section, as it was called, which led to their arrest. Well, all of this sparked tremendous initiative even before, quotes, the movement arose, and we're talking about, give or take, 1961 and 62. And additionally, there were strong peace groups that were beginning to emerge, thanks in part to the fear of an onset of a Third World War and a nuclear holocaust, which, oddly enough, again, movies like On the Beach fostered. You know, the fear, they fostered that fear. So organizations began to appear. One, in response to the peace issue, you not only had Women's Strike for Peace, but you had a new organization, I think it was new at the time, called Students' Peace Union, SPU, which was a pacifist movement. And that began to develop a following on the campus, because you must remember that in the late 50s and early 60s, many students were still very conservative. They were going for Ayn Rand and right-wing libertarianism, you know, and what I would call proprietarianism, and Barry Goldwater. You know, the mood on the campus was one that Buckley, William Buckley, would have loved and which he capitalized on. So now, new kinds of groups, more left-wing in orientation and pacifist in orientation, began to appear, called the Students' Peace Movement. And nobody seems to mention that in any chronicles of the 60s, which surprises me. Maybe, I think, I haven't read all the books on the subject by any means, and it's possible that Todd Gitlin does go into it in some detail. So now you began to see this fermentation taking place, and then there was another organization called Committee for Nonviolent Action, or CNVA. They were attached very closely to the War Resisters League, or WRL. They used to swim out to the nuclear submarines. It's very hard to remember these stories, you know. And they used to latch on and sit there so that the nuclear submarines couldn't submerge. And so naval patrol boats had to go out and forcibly drag them from the nuclear submarines, you know. And this would receive a very wide press. It did. Additionally, Dorothy Day, a Catholic worker, a woman I really got to know and admire. I mean, we had our differences, but I really got to admire that woman. I remembered we used to go out near the Battery in Lower Manhattan, and when they played, had these air drills, you know, kids were being subjected to all this drilling in the event of a nuclear attack, the utter futility of which I need hardly tell you. We refused to obey the sirens, so we'd get arrested. And before long, more and more people, with each air drill, as we made more and more news, began to accumulate in larger and larger numbers, until finally the absurdity of these air drills, of these bomb shelters that people were supposed to buy or create in their cellars, and so on and so forth, became very evident to the public. Now, this is kind of pre-movement, but very much part of the ferment that gave rise to what was to be the 60s, with a capital S, okay? Well, in 1962, still indirectly, since I was not a woman, but nonetheless, shall we say, a fellow traveler involved with many of the women in Women's Strike for Peace, involved with Catholic workers, anti-air raid drill activities, and so on. In 1962, I finally left my more or less secluded home family and moved down to the Bronx and moved down to the Lower East Side. Not the Lower East Side, first the Upper West Side, Greenwich Village. I moved to South 7th Avenue South near Sheridan Square. Now that is a major, that was in that day a major area of the Greenwich Village, left-wing Bohemia. There was even a delicatessen right opposite a cigarette store in which everybody sort of came. Michael Harrington, Irving Howe, you name them. I don't know if Susan Sontag would appear. I only met her later on. And all of them loved to eat big pastrami sandwiches, which were delicious at that time, and get into political discussions. So the place was like a cafe of political ferment. And additionally, I was very closely attached to any kind of anti-war movement that existed. For example, Grace Paley, who is now very well known as an author, and her companion ran a peace center right near Sheridan Square, and I got to know both her and her companion very well. And I spoke there a number of times, and all kinds of people would come there and speak, and we'd get ever bigger and bigger crowds, larger and larger crowds. So something was going on, you begin to see. Now, the first great big move was the development, so far as I was concerned, in the North, of CORE, the Congress of Racial Equality. The Congress of Racial Equality tried to be the counterpart of the NAACP in the South. Picket lines, they began to establish picket lines around Woolworth's stores because of the discrimination that existed in the South in Woolworth's stores and the division between colored and white, as it was called down South. And before long, I started going on these picket lines. And then when I moved to the Lower East Side on Avenue A, near 13th Street, between 13th and 14th Street, the movement began to really swell out. CNVA, Committee for Nonviolent Action, were really the first hippies I had ever seen. In fact, in a very real sense, they developed the costume that many hippies were to wear later on in the 60s. They began to have ponytails, beards. Being pacifists in many cases, they wore cord-like or canvas sandals. They often dressed in jeans. Now, you must realize how uncommon this was. This was not even part of the bohemian scene. So these pacifists from CNVA, wearing long hair, wearing beards, growing beards, were rather unique at that point, and smoking pot. And I'd see a heck of a lot of them because of my relationship with CNVA and WRL on Lafayette Street. which is where their main headquarters were. Additionally, we began to move more and more with, I began to get more and more involved with CORE, which was located on 13th Street between Avenue A and Avenue B. Avenue B had a bar called Charlie's Bar, which I understand now is called Mona's Bar. I don't know. It's got a long history. In any case, in 1962 and 63, Charlie's Bar was really a beatnik bar. It had originally been an old Polish bar. But beatniks began to take over, and I don't know if you know what beatniks used to look like in those days, but they used to dress in black berets or, you know, navy blue berets, or what we'd call Basque berets, and they'd wear shades all the time, night or day. And the bar was usually dark enough so that you could hardly see each other. If you wore, you just looked with your eyes and you had 20/20 vision. It was, you know, dim. American bars are dim. They're not like British bars, which are all lit up. So in would come a beatnik, you know what I mean, feel his way through the dark, wearing shades. And you might fall in Allen Ginsberg's lap, you know, or Ed Sanders's lap, or whatever you want, Tully Kupferberger's lap. In any case, we all hung out over there. And it became a center, first for beatnik activity and later more radical activity. Because in between Avenue A and B on 13th Street, CORE had opened up a store and held meetings there and held and kept its literature there. We had Mickey Schwerner, who was to die in Mississippi in the famous death of the three Mississippi young people, Schwerner, Cheney, and Goodman, about which they made movies and are now legendary in the history of the civil rights movement. And the CORE chapter there, called East Side CORE, which I was later to join, had affiliations with these young people working in Mississippi in the Mississippi summer campaigns to register black voters, which was extremely dangerous. I mean, literally, people died. And no, you know, it was not inconsequential at all. Mickey died and was buried together with Cheney and Goodman in a dam. And their bodies were not found for weeks later. So I began to attend the CORE meetings as well. And before long, I was up to my ears in 1964 in activities around racism, specifically around Jim Crow activities, boycotting, getting arrested for sit-ins, and so on and so forth. And we now began to escalate this campaign enormously, and before long, civil rights was really right in front of everything. And that really started the movement going. I met SNCC organizers. I remember Robert Moses, for example, who was one of the founders of SNCC, or the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, and who were these, I would say, the cutting edge of black youth in the South. And they also brought in all the costuming that we associate with the 60s, not only jean trousers, but jean jackets, because they worked with sharecroppers. They were out there in the fields with these people. And they were under the eyes of sheriffs who had guns trained on them half the time. Let's not kid ourselves that this was play. And they would come up north to get support. So they started to lay the bases for what I would call the movement. And I had many, you know, there was a lot of singing and doing and going to Harlem and going on picket lines and going on demonstrations and getting busted and so forth. And I became very active in CORE. So these laid the foundations for the direct action movements. No hippies were around at that point. Hippies began to appear, long hairs, countercultural people began to appear about a year later, give or take, I would say, the end of 1964 into the early part of 1965. The movement was therefore, at that point, particularly political. SDS was small. Students for a Democratic Society, SDS, was small. I remember when they had to change their lock because the League for Industrial Democracy, which at that time was led by Michael Harrington, much revered today and memorialized since his death, but at that time very ambiguous about his attitude toward the Vietnam War. He was more to the right, and people tend to forget that. And I would suspect that this was equally true of many people who were in the dissent crowd at that point, by which I mean Irving Howe. These were the old-time socialists who were very much, in a sense, exhibited a certain partisanship on the side of the United States in the Cold War, and therefore tended or were biased or tilted toward either not saying anything about what was going on in Vietnam or even supporting it. So people have a very mixed perspective about what happened in the 60s and who was lined up with who. The civil rights movement was the spearhead. Women's strike for peace began to fade. Student peace movement was one of the spearheads and increasingly was replaced by Students for a Democratic Society, particularly when the Port Huron Statement, ostensibly written by Jane Fonda's husband,
Tom Hayden,
whom I got to know in a very unsatisfactory relationship, and ERAP, which was a program that that SDS had working in neighborhoods such as Newark, New Jersey, in which Hayden played a big role. The movement began to shape up around this political form, and already hippie types, but not hippies, namely peace activists, were dressing like hippies and behaving like hippies and even forming communes, a major one of which was in Rhode Island, which I had the distinction of going to. Now, the hippies began to come in too. And I was very active in CORE. And when the 1964 black uprising took place in Harlem, and many people forget that Harlem had the first real black uprising before Watts and before Newark and before Detroit, my CORE chapter was very deeply involved in it, although I personally was asked not to come down because I was white. They only wanted blacks. So I became deeply involved, and I began to see already something new emerging. This was no longer the old workers' movement, the movement, the 60s were no longer the old workers' movement that I had known so very well during the great trade union uprising and strikes of the 1930s, of the highly politicized socialists, communists, Trotskyists, and so on and so forth. These were populist movements. They cut across a lot of lines, and a lot of people from different classes essentially overlapped with each other and created something very new, a movement that was designed not only for economic justice, which is was primarily the goal of the 1930s movements, which were in those days explicitly revolutionary. They were talking about a new kind of democracy, a participatory democracy. And by participatory, they meant not only one that embraced everyone, people of all different races, nationalities, and so on. Ultimately, the feminist movement was to come out of that so that all could participate in the democracy. But they advanced ideas of direct face-to-face democracy. So people were no longer leaders in these movements. They were coordinators. They were facilitators. And you sat in a circle normally instead of the usual student-type college-teacher relationship. Attempts were made to arrive at consensus, a Quaker influence, but still a point about, you know, trying to achieve general agreement, although I felt that it was always necessary if push came to shove and no decision could be made to go to a vote. I never accepted mere consensus. So I was involved in CORE by that time. And in 1964, we closed down the World's Fair in New York City. Literally closed it down for a whole day. I was arrested in front of the Florida Pavilion, spent a week in what was amounted to a prisoner of war concentration camp from the Second World War with turrets and everything like that, and finally released and spent a year going in and out of courts trying to negotiate our situation with the judiciary. So the movement began in that form, from the civil rights movement primarily, from the anti-war movement primarily, and you had parallel movements in the North, as I indicated, to those that existed in the South. You not only had CORE, which paralleled the NAACP, but was more involved in direct action, whereas the NAACP was primarily involved, the NAACP being the National Association for Colored People, for the Advancement of Colored People, but you had in CORE a more militant direct action organization. And then additionally, you had the students, Northern Students Movement, which everybody has forgotten about, paralleling SNCC, that the Northern Students Movement tried to organize black students in Northern universities, just as SNCC, Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, did so in Southern universities. SNCC had very little impact on the North. It was primarily a Southern movement. We didn't have anything like the Black Panthers. The movement was broadly populist, and perhaps its best ideas were presented in the Port Huron Statement, which, despite the so-called liberal quality of the Port Huron Statement, was magnificent in its expression of alienation, its feeling that capitalism had deprived people of any meaning in life, that we are the youth who are seeking a meaning, who are seeking broader goals, a tremendously powerful ethical statement, which, whether Tom Hayden wrote all of it or part of it, was one of the most effective mobilizing documents we had at that time. At that particular point, too, as 1964 wore on, I became very disillusioned with the Congress of Racial Equality. Power politics began to occur, and the movement began to shift more and more toward a black-only type of organization, as occurred with SNCC. Namely, the idea of black power came to the forefront. As a result, many whites, like myself, began to withdraw, and we started a study circle on Elridge Avenue. My dear friend, at that time, essentially a son, we were separated from each other by some 25 years or 20 years, Alan Hoffman, who had been a CORE organizer, began to grow and had been on peace marches clear across the country, began to grow long hair, as was common among many of the peace activists, began to wear sandals, began to wear jeans. The whole costuming of the hippies began to appear. There were, of course, spiritualistic tendencies in these movements. A lot of people read Albert Camus. They went on to read Lao Tzu. They began to use the I Ching, flipping coins to find out what they should do, what advice the books had to offer. And a certain element of mysticism appeared, which I, frankly, was very alienated from, but which was always mingled up with politics, always mingled up with politics, anti-war activism. And our study group eventually decided to form the East Side Anarchists. We got a bookstore on 9th Street around 1935. We issued a magazine called Good Soup, which contained a whole series of proclamations, playful on the one side but very serious on the other. One of our closest comrades was in prison for draft resistance, and in those days they came down very hard, and had been beaten up in Southern jails during his civil rights activities. He was white, but he was part of the bus riders that kept on going down to the South. And additionally, we were visited by people like Ben Morea, who was at that time turning out a broadsheet which he pasted up all over town called Black Mask. Now that was later, his group was later to turn into Up Against the Wall Motherfucker, which many young people right now are deeply enamored of, but I think should be put in a proper perspective, which I will be glad to go into if you wish. And now we began to feel that the whole world was beginning to change. For one thing, we heard of the Provos. This was a youth movement in Holland called the Provetariat, as they like to name themselves. Provo meant provoke, to get people to think. And they began to do all kinds of gallivanting all over the city of Amsterdam, all over Dutch cities, turning out all kinds of marvelous leaflets, calling upon people to express themselves, to take their destiny into their own hands, but they did it playfully. One time they gave out leaflets, and on it said, write your own leaflet. And the cops would play games with them all over the place. It was very difficult to catch them. They were very clever. And they began to get a worldwide reputation, which has been totally forgotten today. In Japan, a very tough student movement called the Zengakuren, locking arms, putting on helmets, gas masks, or big heavy-duty handkerchiefs soaked in water, and, you know, even carrying bamboo sticks to fight with the cops, would engage the police in ongoing struggle. Paris was very quiet. That was the amazing thing about it in the mid-60s. And soon, SDS branches began to become very prominent. They replaced Students for a Democratic Society. They even came into the forefront of the anti-Vietnam War struggle because CORE, in fact, shrank to a great extent because it excluded whites, as did many of the civil rights movements in the South. They did not get that much larger after the Mississippi summer. And as they moved more and more toward black power, they became more exclusionary. So I began to play around, as it were, with Students for a Democratic Society. I was too old. I was not a student. This was a youth movement. But Students for a Democratic Society really developed a network across most of the country. Strangely enough, hardly at all in California. California had been sort of generating its own energy, starting out with the free speech movement in 1964, and going on to form communal lives in small subgroups or groupuscules, as the French like to call it. But still politically very active, very intense, filled with debate. Up to now, these movements were basically libertarian or anarchic in character. They believed in participatory democracy. They didn't single out the working class as being the hegemonic agent that would make social change. In fact, very frequently, peace activists were beaten up by workers, at least on the East Coast. Construction workers, with one particular point, came clambering into a demonstration that was held in front of the Treasury Building in Wall Street and beat up on the students left and right. The hard hat was almost a symbol for some of us, comparable to that of the Nazi helmets in the Second World War. But now we began, a tremendous ferment began to develop. We lived on, living on the Lower East Side. We had a whole area of Tompkins Square Park to ourselves, which was the largest park on the Lower East Side. There was a distinct quadrant in which only radicals and hippies would sit. Women coming in, long hairs, often walking bare feet without any shoes on city streets, which always amazed me, frankly, as being an older person. But still, if they were willing to do it, so be it. With their children, usually carrying them the way squaws did, or in sacks over their shoulders with long, sheer dresses going right down to their ankles, and the long hair, in many cases, golden, blue-eyed, very innocent-looking kids, some of whom came from California. And we began to hear about a California hippie scene, an upsurge. So now the 60s really began to unfold. There were a whole series of demonstrations that occurred in New York City in which we as the Lower East Side anarchists, our former study circle burgeoning into something of a minor movement, carried our own black anarchist flags, had huge banners in which we had ecology, community, peace, if you like. Everybody knew what every word meant except ecology. Remember that ecology was unknown. At that time, too, I was very active writing about ecology. I wrote Ecology and Revolutionary Thought in 64 and Toward Liberatory Technology in 1965, which proposed for the first time the use of solar energy, wind power, and things of that nature, as well as organic gardening. Our group, in turn, went up into the country visiting a friend who had a farm where they learned how to do organic gardening and actually got into the hands-on work involved in this enterprise. But things began to change in the 60s, especially after 65, 66, I would say. The Trotskyists and the Maoists, forming Progressive Labor Party, saw a wonderful opportunity here to bring in their own old orthodox forms of 30s Marxism, which by now had been outlived. This was no longer a world in which the sharp class definitions of worker and peasant and who knows what, certainly there were capitalists, but a middle-class mentality prevailed, and one that had no clear class definition. Even workers thought of themselves primarily as middle-class people. They did not think of themselves as workers. They may have belonged to unions, but the unions were simply machines for getting them better benefits. And one could understand why they would belong to them, but they did not challenge the social system to the extent even that the unions did in the 1930s. So the Marxists began to come in, Marxist, Leninist, Maoists, and Trotskyists. They began to enter into SDS or form movements of their own to compete with SDS. And the whole tenor of the 60s began to undergo change by 1966 in the United States. For one thing, there was an overwhelming orientation on the part of all the movements that were involved, at least in political activity. I'm not talking of the peace movement as such. I'm talking of SDS and specifically of various other left sectarian groups toward the Third World. Now, my belief was that they should be oriented toward the Third World. Quite obviously, I had fought against imperialism all my life. But they now began to talk to Americans as though the Third World was the proletariat, which it was not. It was a peasant world, as though the uprisings in Vietnam and the NLF, National Liberation Front, and the Battle of Algiers, that movie that has made such a profound effect upon everybody, created that image that we were in the rear guard and the Third World was in the vanguard, and we had to have a Third World orientation entirely. Personally, I argued not so much against the need to withdraw American troops. On that, there was no question. I was opposed to the war. But several things bothered me, and which became crucial issues. One, I did not agree with Northern Vietnam. It was a totalitarian state, and I felt that you did not have to support North Vietnam to oppose American involvement in Vietnam. I did not feel that you had to give the Cuban people the right to decide what their destiny is, and yet on the other side support Castro. I did not support Castro. I did not support dictatorships. I was a left-wing libertarian. I was against all kinds of states, and I did not particularly feel any need to link up. In fact, I was very hostile to the attempt to link up with Castro, with Ho Chi Minh, with Mao Zedong, whom I felt were statists and totalitarians, which did not mean that I supported American involvement in the affairs of China, Cuba, and Vietnam. In no such case would I give ground on a basic principled position that I opposed the state, that I opposed totalitarian states, but that didn't mean that I was going to support the United States in what it was doing in Vietnam or what American troops were being forced to do in Vietnam. The Marxist, Leninist, Maoist, in Albanian, you have no idea what a variety of them there were, you know. There were those who supported Horthy and God knows what, all of these things. I'm not sure if I have the name right. Albanian, who were opposed to the Cuban, who were opposed, but still all of them were totalitarian oriented. And so it was very important, I thought, to have a presence, and we as anarchists decided to create a presence that would be independent of this orientation toward the Third World, and very importantly, too, to recognize that it was only by making change in the United States that we would really be helping the Third World people. That was key. It was a very important issue. I mean, I even understand that Ho Chi Minh told American delegations coming to North Vietnam to go back to the United States and not worry so much about what he is doing or supporting him or calling themselves extensions of the National Liberation Front in Vietnam. He said, go back home and win over the American people and change the United States. And in this respect, he was absolutely right. And very importantly, As the years began to go by, and we got into 66 and 67, after a number of major demonstrations, one of the most important initiating demonstrations being the one called by SDS, I think it was in 64 in Washington, in which they managed to corral 10,000 people and make them aware of the Vietnam War. You know, people were not even aware of the fact that there were Americans fighting in Vietnam early in the 60s. That only became a big issue when the draft began to expand and when Lyndon Johnson began to throw in hundreds of thousands of American soldiers instead of a few thousand or 10,000 or something like that. So, these organizations, Marxist-Leninist, Maoist organizations came in there and they began to change the 60s. They began to try to make it look like the 30s. In other words, they were digging up graveyards. They were ready to pull out any casket that looked like the old Congress of Industrial Organizations that led strikes in the 1930s, the great strike movement of the 1930s. They started talking about worker-student alliance. André Gortz, for example, just like one author, a Frenchman, gave us a lot of trouble. He came out with a book called New Strategy for Labor, telling students that they were workers. They were not workers. What was the point in kidding themselves about it? And so one started to hear of worker-student alliances and that students were proletarians working in a place, factory called the university. Whereas in point of fact, they were very privileged. And this was important. The one basic underlying, I would say, economic reason that made such movements possible was that it was the country was so affluent at the time that you could live off the fat. You could afford to live off the fat, you know what I mean, of capitalist affluence. For all the derogation, all the sharp remarks that were made about consumerism, it was primarily this affluence that existed in those idyllic Johnson more than New Deal years. You know, Johnson gave far more in many respects than any liberal since Franklin D. Roosevelt, despite his policies on Vietnam, to the American people. He introduced Medicare for elderly people. He introduced all kinds of youth programs. I mean, money was flowing out of Washington like mad, not only for the war, but for social welfare. And he thought of him, he, Johnson, thought of himself as the heir to Franklin D. Roosevelt. So it was that fact, that feeling of post-scarcity, that we could go, we did not have to work this hard, that we could live lives of genteel simplicity, that we could get down to essentials because the goods were around to provide us with the means of life, and the promise of technology that it might provide us with an abundance of goods if only we could learn to live cooperatively, that fed this movement. Had there been an economic crisis, you couldn't have had this kind of movement. Had there been massive hunger, at least among that affected middle-class youth coming out of the suburbs into the cities, you couldn't have had this kind of movement. This movement was very strongly predicated on the enormous potentiality of the American economy to give people all that they needed, at least in the basic means of life, and all the freedom of time to engage in political activity and in cultural activity as well. And it was very important to recognize that this, shall we say, growing post-scarcity mentality, that we now had reached the point where technology and the enormity of the American industrial machine could make life comfortable, possible, and even provide leisure time for workers themselves, not only for people from the middle classes, that automation could replace labor. You see, the attitude was positive toward technology, and that you could even have solar power instead of fossil fuel power that was ecologically harmful, that made this movement come to life. It was also black expectations of a better life, which they saw white suburbans enjoying, whether in the movies or elsewhere, or even around themselves, that gave rise in great measure to the civil rights movement, and also promoted the idea that people could participate. They would be freed from the ardors of labor to participate in political life and in a participatory democracy. So these are anarchic ideas were there. These anarchic ideas of post-scarcity, which I, for one, very strongly tried to develop and cultivate. Do you gave rise to a utopian vision of what could happen. And that utopian vision was not mere myth. It was based on the very substantial facts of emerging automation, of growing productivity, of a tremendous amount of economic superfluity and wealth, an abundance of goods, the opportunity to have free time. And you could live off the garbage of the society, which made the counterculture possible. The counterculture became possible because you could go down to the Fulton Fish Market, say in New York City at 4 o'clock in the morning, get all the free fish you wanted. They didn't know what to do with the stuff. You could go to various fruit and vegetable markets early in the morning and pick up whatever you wanted. It was possible to get bread that was 2 days old. It was possible to pick up milk bottles. There was a semi-degree of theft in that, you know? But the point is, food was simply available. It was that available at that particular point. Apartments were extremely cheap on the Lower East Side, and in many areas, I would guess, of San Francisco, $25 to $35 a month. You were prepared, and living communally, it was very easy to do. Only one person possibly working. Many of the young women at that time were models, and for better or worse, got involved with body painting and near-sexual professions, shall we say, like topless dancing and the like. But the idea of nudity was so commonplace, and this idea of a liberation through sexuality, through desire, through art, were major themes of the counterculture, as well as communal living, macrobiotic food, which was quite easy to acquire, basically premised around rice and simply cooked vegetables. And so consequently, young people coming in from the suburbs or coming in from different parts of the country to the Lower East Side or possibly to the Haight-Ashbury, about which I knew very little as yet, could find a way of life. And so we always engaged in discussion. And we engaged in action, and we began to get printing presses. We built up the Bowery Poets Co-op and everything like that, so that poets in the Lower East Side and the best, the top of the lot, who are now established in American poetry, would declaim and deliver of their feelings before irate feelings and loving feelings before sizable audiences. And in one way or another, we had our own presses, and we could turn out this enormous literature. When, in fact, 68 began to approach in the United States, the movement was really being torn apart by very serious conflicts. Its high point was in the United States was 66, just as its high point in France was May-June 68. France lagged behind the United States, and I later found out about that when I went to France in 1967. The high point, the populist level, the anarchic level of the movement, in SDS particularly, reached its high point around 66. And by 67, with the entry of progressive labor into SDS and its attempts form caucuses and control SDS with its very hard-line Marxist-Leninist-Maoist ideology, and the Trotskyists forming their own student organization to compete with SDS. All of this began to lead to serious frictions inside the movement, which was still growing and growing. Flags were raised, North Vietnamese flags, which I objected to because I felt that we were not part of the National Liberation Front in Vietnam. We were not fighting on the battlefields of North Vietnam, of Vietnam against American imperialism. I felt that the main point was to talk to the American people in their own language, express through our aspirations what were their hidden aspirations, to bring to the surface the unconscious impulses they had about the boredom of American suburbia, about the tediousness of work that was really unnecessary at that point, to talk to them about a bright utopian future to give them a sense of hope. A world visualized in such a way that they could believe they could really reconstruct the society and create a utopia, because the means seem to be there. And that utopian dimension was very important for me, as it was for the anarchists with whom I was working. However, a surly element began to appear in the movement. For one thing, within the black movement itself, a distinctly anti-white attitude appeared. Aside from the Panthers, who were prepared to work with the whites, SNCC was already moving toward an anti-white position. And that was not exactly a position that was calculated to win the hearts and minds of America. Black people are, for better or worse, 10% of the population, give or take 14% of the population. One had to reach the whites. This was exacerbated by the earlier Malcolm X, who later on changed his mind after he went to Mecca and broke with Elijah Muhammad, finally resulting in his death. But that surly black power movement of hostility toward whites, even white supporters, began to become a very powerful fact. So that was one major division that occurred. A second major division was essentially between young radicals who weren't committed to a Marxist, Leninist, Stalinist, Maoist position, and these Marxist, Leninist, Maoist, Trotskyist, Stalinist, call them whatever you like, factions that were trying to eat into the movement and to literally exploit it, to squeeze it dry, gain members from it. They were not interested in the movement as such. They were interested in building their own vanguard Bolshevik parties, as they construed Bolshevism, in the most narrowest dogmatic terms. Then there were those from the older SDS, at least the best of them, who felt totally alienated and couldn't get along with these hard-line 1930s, and they were a caricature of the 1930s, because there was no workers' movement around at the time. So they were really a joke, a mockery of the 1930s, which had some real life to it, and revolutionary life to it. They were playing their corrosive game. Additionally, and I can't say this with any great... short of being dishonest, I must have to tell you that certain anarchist tendencies played a very bad role in the movement. More specifically, the Up Against the Wall Motherfucker group, which Ben Murray had formed out of Black Mask. Up Against the Wall Motherfuckers were originally called, first they called themselves Black Mask, and they only consisted of about four or five people. But they managed to put up so many posters denouncing Ginsburg for selling out, or Tim Leary for selling out, and whatever you like, you know, they were filled with denunciations and plastered them over New York to such an extent and sent them out internationally to such an extent that people thought it was a mass movement. There were only five people in there. It was Ben Maria, his wife Janice. I saw once in a while Jeff Jones, who later became a leader of Weathermen, blonde-haired chap. I saw a few others, you know what I mean, who were interlopers. And essentially their main job was to take Ben Maria's art and plaster it up on the walls, not only of Lower East Side buildings, but on the West Side, and before long, wherever they could put them up. So people thought there was this huge mass movement, which didn't even exist in fact. Later on, Black Mask became ESSO, which meant East Side Service Organization, a play on the oil company now called Exxon. That money came from the city of New York, oddly enough. Mayor Lindsay was so eager to try to calm the city, that he did a number of things. For one thing, he hired the Bread and Puppet Theater to cool things down during the hot summer nights when there might be trouble. And there was always, and the Lower East Side was always on the edge of a riot, on the edge of a riot between the hippies and the Puerto Ricans feeling that they wanted to beat the hell out of the hippies, because they were raising the rents, you see, as hippies came in and occupied apartments, they created an increasing shortage, and the landlords began to up the ante so far as rents were concerned, and that affected Puerto Ricans as well as everyone else. Secondly, the flaunting sexuality of the hippies, young women who never wore brassieres, who hardly wore any clothing, as it were, walking barefoot with their long flowing hair and their, ethnically speaking, very American faces, you know, fair, blue-eyed, and so on, formed a sharp contrast to the ethnically underprivileged Puerto Ricans. And a Puerto Rican life, cultural life, being very much influenced by Catholicism, you know, looked upon, many Puerto Ricans, the young men, looked upon these women as potential bait for rape and licentiousness. And consequently, there were tensions building around that. Puerto Rican women, understandably, feeling very irritated that their men were beginning to eye these Hollywood-type beauties, you know what I mean, walking around them barefoot, and their breasts bouncing very freely all over the place and practically visible through the sheer of the clothing that they wore, thin clothing that they wore. So there was always this potential for a riot. And sooner or later, one did explode, somewhere around 1967 or 68, in which, and then there was a tremendous hatred of the police. We had Tactical Patrol Force, the TPF, which had been organized and were living essentially out of buses to go from one riot zone to another, or one potential riot zone to another. Usually guys who were well over 6 feet tall, they were selected for their prowess, and they were trained to deal with crowds, and they did so rather effectively and brutally, and the Puerto Ricans felt that their neighborhood, essentially, the Lower East Side, was a garrison, that they were in a camp, and that they were being patrolled, as well as everyone else being patrolled. So these tensions crisscrossing all over the place made for a great deal of neighborhood hostilities, and that began to come to the surface, particularly in 67. Additionally, there were all kinds of division, regional divisions within the movement. There were the pacifists, first of all, ideological. There were the pacifists who didn't believe in any violence. There were the Marxist-Leninists, etc., and even many of the anarchists who believed in a good deal of violence. The motherfuckers who exuded a violent rhetoric all over the place. They did not engage in violence. And I knew them very well. They used to come to my house pretty often. And but still, I mean, they engage in what you'd call cultural terrorism. They're the ones who began to put up some of the most famous posters of, was it Sitting Bull, or was it with the famous 30-30 caliber lever action rifle, you know, on his knee. They were the ones who introduced the Cubano-type cigarette-smoking, radical-looking images. They were the ones who composed the verses to what were the greater part of a song that Gracie Slick popularized called The Volunteers of America. We are the children you hate. We're going to come out of our dungeons. I'm improvising the words right now. They would occupy the full, we had underground newspapers, which were very widely read, and they were given the centerfold to do whatever they wanted. So the poetry would appear there, the imagery would appear there, smoking guns, you know, the whole image of violence. And in the meantime, the pacifists are withdrawing from the movement and feeling shocked and shaken. And very importantly, were the great mobilization demonstrations that began to take place. Mobilization against war. There were so many mobs, mobilizations, or mobs as we call them, that I already forgot their names. There were mobs about this and mobs about that. Dave Dellinger was one of the most conspicuous figures at that particular time. And the mob generally consisted of representatives of fairly staid, middle-class type organizations, anti-war, like SANE, Nuclear Policy Committee, which I don't particularly care to go into, and respectable organizations, and also pretty rebellious ones. The orientation of the mobs was primarily toward Washington. They were primarily interested in bringing as many people to Washington to protest against the war as possible, and that became a whole year-round effort. It wasn't something that occurred from time to time as one incident went on, one demonstration followed another. It was like they were always engaged in doing one thing, taking you out of where you lived and bringing you to Washington in buses, in cars, by railroad, gathering you together in large numbers, marching in the tens finally the hundreds of thousands in Washington. And then you'd go home and you'd look at yourself in television and that would be your activity. I'm not saying this was true of everyone involved, but it was true of far too many involved. The idea of doing local work, of demonstrating on a local basis, of not trying to seek the respectability that was accorded by Mayor Lindsay to many demonstrations in which he marched and spoke, no less. All of this began to change the tenor of the movement. A kind of angry movement developed against this mob. There were two movements now to begin with. Mob, speaking for the Washington demonstrators and the people that could mobilize, and doing very little local work by comparison with other groups. Then there were the radical part of the movement, and that consisted of groups who wanted to engage in real actions in the streets and also do local work and concentrate on local demonstrations if you were going to demonstrate. And then inside the radical movement, there were all these different factions that I've described. There were the Trotskyists, the Maoists, the anarchic types, and then there were the cultural terrorists, quotes, close quote. They didn't engage in actual terrorist activity, led by the motherfuckers, whose main job was to blow people's minds through disruption. Now, I believe in blowing people's minds, okay? I believe it's important at times to be very direct about your opposition and even seemingly disruptive. I believe it is very important to engage in direct action. But to make that the alpha and omega of your position was, in my view, a disaster. It meant breaking up opposing organization as such. And the motherfuckers entering into SDS with their new store, which indirectly was funded by the city of New York. Not that they were minions of Mayor Lindsay, I assure you that they were beyond that kind of manipulation at all. They definitely believed very emphatically in what they were doing, dumping garbage in Lincoln Center during the garbage strike, because they said that cultural garbage, they were cultural radicals, but saying that cultural garbage was being produced by Lincoln Center, carrying on in a, was it a summer solstice or spring solstice, I don't remember which, I'm not sure I got my solstices and equinoxes mixed up properly, really led to a riot in Grand Central Station. I remember going down to that and seeing the whole thing happen. It was a hell of a mess. It was a police riot in which about 1,000 kids were chased all over the place and dozens of them were beaten down to a pulp. One of them actually had all his nerves severed in his arm because he was pushed through these great plate glass doors that open into Grand Central Station. We're talking of glass that's about a half inch thick and beaten up all over the place. This led to a tremendous scandal at the time over WBAI's discussions going on about what had happened. But that cultural terrorism led to nowhere. It was drift. It was without program. It was without direction. And there were attempts by some of us who were trying to give a sense of coherence, and this is very important. We were trying to give a sense of coherence and organization to what we felt was important in the United States at that time. We believed that there had to be a program, there had to be a utopian vision, there had to be positive suggestions, there had to be a radical movement directed against capitalism, but one that could be expressed in terms comprehensible to ordinary Americans, not the ultra-leftist, super-imperialist nature of blah, 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 using the jargon of vanguardism or rearguardism or fascism. You know, stop taking out of Lenin's writings. That wasn't speaking to the American people. We had to talk more in terms of the American Revolution if we were going to talk about anything, and there was a tremendously radical dimension to the American Revolution, as I'm delineating right now in my a book called The Third Revolution. I've given an account of that type of life and the extremely revolutionary nature of the American Revolution. And so all these tendencies were now beginning to emerge inside the movement, and the movement became very acerbic, very sharp, fights going on, debates going on, between this tendency and that tendency. And for all the artistry that has been imputed to the movement at that time, one must also remember that there was a very bitter, sweet sharpness about the movement after 1966 and 1967. In 1967, however, and I already was working with a group of my own comrades called the Anarchos Group, we were turning out a magazine that was amazingly influential. Our 2,000 copies must have reached about 20,000 people, considering the kind of mail we got and the kind of reaction we got to our periodical. I went to Europe. There I traveled all over the place. I saw, looked at the provosts, talked to Raoul van Dien, who was one of the founders of the provosts. They were waning, dying out in Amsterdam. Later they were to return as the Kabouters. I went to Sweden, Norway, Germany. I did not see any real political life. And particularly in France, where I met the Situationists and brought their material to the United States, for which I will forever regret. I met Guy Debord, Raoul Van Agem, Mustafa Kayati, all the top leaders of the Situationists. And they had a very strong, basically centralist movement, guided by Guy Debord. He was the Pope. Small as they were and very exclusionary. And if you got expelled from the Situationists, they wouldn't talk to you, which made me feel very irritated with their point of view. I had seen these things in the Young Communist League in the 1930s. And additionally, very significantly, they were really, strangely enough, despite the image that they now create among young people as being cultural revolutionaries, they were not that at all. They believed in workers' councils. Their ideology goes back to 1910, to Anton Panikowicz, who believed in council communism. They were completely obsessed with the proletariat. They were not interested in students. They were not interested in youth. They thought the American counterculture and the youth movement and SDS and everything else was a shock. Their ideas basically were literary, very textual. Guy Debord was above all a writer who wrote in a relatively obscure style. Raoul Van Agem, who's more widely read now among all of them, was a man who lived a very middle-class life in Belgium, really suburban, and dressed accordingly, you know, and one wouldn't have been able to tell the difference between him and his habits, decent as it was, and his behavior from that of any middle-class suburban life, suburbanite. The only one they had who was a flaming revolutionary in that whole crowd, frankly, was Mustafa Kayati, who identified with the Fellahin, or better still, the PLO, and wanted to go back to the Middle East to carry on terrorist activity. That at least was the impression I had. They were very patriarchal, amazingly so. And they were the only things that I saw in Paris at that time in 67. And I'm talking of August and September and October 1967. And as I said in a previous interview, many of the French radicals I met wanted to come to the United States, where Abby Hoffman was levitating the Pentagon in a huge demonstration, where the Yippies were running wild, where all kinds of things seemed to be happening. Whereas it was death warmed over in Paris in 67. And then when I left in November 67, I left with a sense of relief. I wanted to get the hell out. The Situationists were interesting, but I couldn't go along with their workers' movement, which was dead in my mind as of the 1930s. I couldn't go along with their almost Leninist type of organization and their way of dealing with the people who they opposed and those who left their movement and were treated as non-humans. You could understand the French Revolutionary Terror and the guillotine when you saw this sort of stuff. I came back to the United States. I immediately got involved in all the activity that was going on, went to San Francisco. I had been to the Haight-Ashbury and had seen the great flock of hippies going along there. An incredible scene, you know, literally herds of hippies moving up and down the street and heading toward the park at the end of either the Haight or the Ashbury, communes everywhere. But in a way, there was something empty about it. Everybody loved everybody so much. that the love became meaningless. When you love everybody, you don't love anybody in particular. And the solidarity that I had hoped to see in the communes was very arguable, because most of the communes in the Haight-Ashbury were really crash pads. People came and went. And so it was just a scene. It had no real life, and it had no political content, or very little political content. I met Emmett Grogan of the Diggers. He had come to New York and tried to start a digger movement going. I hope people haven't forgotten that movement, in which they were going to give things away for nothing, you know. Everything was going to be a freebie. They were going to collect wherever they could goods and provide hippies with meals, food, clothing, whatever they needed. And Grogan tried to create the same movement in New York, but he couldn't, because New York is a tougher climate, you know. It isn't the Haight-Ashbury. I met him, I met Peter, whatever his name is. His name will come to me. He's now the bigwig and hoo-ha of the bioregionalist movement. And they came to New York City again to rescue us, but they didn't quite make it, and I went back to I went to San Francisco, and I met them. I went to Berkeley, and there was the usual, all the tables laid out in Sproul Plaza with the militant, with the this and the that, various radical periodicals. It was a lot of spiritualism at the same time, but at least there was something going on. And finally, about give or take what, January, February, March, thereabouts, or April 1968, Columbia Blue, Columbia University. Students occupied the campuses. the issue basically had to do with whether or not a student gymnasium was going to be built on a plot of land that seemed to be part of Harlem, although it was, I think, up in the Heights. And that plot of land was used by blacks living in Harlem to disport themselves, to possibly picnic, and, you know, kids to have a good time. And SDS and others made a big issue, radical students made a big issue about not building the gymnasium, but turning it over to the people of Harlem, which the university refused to do. It was its land it claimed, and it wanted to build a student gymnasium. So the students went out on a strike, and a number of halls were occupied according to whether or not you were one kind of a radical or another, or whether you belonged to one ethnic group or another. One hall was occupied entirely by blacks. Another one was occupied by more or less middle-class, liberalistic or left-leaning youth, and the third one was occupied almost entirely by the violent ones, you know, the ultra-revolutionaries who were part of the movement. And what happened there was that this strike attracted nationwide attention, probably international attention. And a whole cultural life was built in all these different halls, depending upon what your political disposition was. The ultra-revolutionaries were supposed to have oiled the staircases so that the police, if they attacked them, would slip, and broken glass all over the place, and broken up furniture for clubs, barricades, to fight the cops. The blacks were very quiet. We didn't know quite what was going on in their building. And the whites were wide open. The middle-class whites were wide open, windows open, kids were having a good time. The Strawberry Statement movie was built around that one hall. And the police seemed hesitant about what they were going to do. Ultimately, what really happened, and this is not commonly known, is, to the best of my knowledge, the black leaders made a deal with the cops and essentially deserted, very frankly, the rest of the students, both the liberal type or left liberal types, and even the militants with their oiled staircases and glass on the floor and barricades on the wall. And they were let out very quietly, because I think whoever was the mayor at that time, I think it was Lindsay, did not want to foment any black antagonism. Once they were let out, the police came in with everything they had. I didn't sleep over. I only lived about an hour drive away by subway, so being older, that was not exactly my lifestyle, to sleep on a schoolroom floor or drape myself in a chair somewhere. I couldn't take it physically, but I would always come down there again to be as active and helpful as I could. Our group was also involved in that. And having walked out, blacks were let out through tunnels, unknown to everybody else. The police came crashing in with everything they had against the middle class, more or less left liberal kids, and beat the hell out of them. I must tell you, it was mayhem. The reports I got from people who were on the scene, even the doctors who were there, first aid people in white coats, were beaten up by cops. People were just smashed wide open.